I think we are not educated to perceive failure as something constructive. Yeah. And one thing you just said about the work of Emmy and Monson, and one thing that we notice on transformation is that it relates to fear, right? Because people love to talk about we need to transform, but when do you go and say, okay, let's do it now? Yeah. Then people say, but can you start transforming on the other side and not on my side? Because people are afraid. So how do you build psychological safety inside the organization? So you are inside organizations doing that. So how do you build this? You know, the safety to try and say, oh God, it didn't work. So
I would start already by distinguishing two worlds in an organization. The world where you exploit and manage the existing, where transformation might be less necessary on a large scale. And the world where you're inventing the future, where transformation is core. And you will have people who are more comfortable with stability. So there are places in companies today where it's really about managing the existing. You have a supply chain. Well, you know, it might not be a good idea to experiment too much because failure can cost you millions up to billions. But you need to create this parallel space, a safe space where you have different culture, different processes, where you launch the transformation. And you should have people there who are very comfortable with transformation. And they lead, you know, the people who might be a little bit less comfortable. But I don't think everybody always needs to change. I think we can look at the company as, these are the stable parts of our company. Let's manage those. And you know, maybe that business model will die over the next 5 years, but we're very comfortable with that dying because we're already building the future. So this will replace that. And then slowly we will move the resources here into new parts of the company. Logitech, very concrete example, CEO Bracken Darrell, when he took over, he reallocated 75% of the resources from the peripherals business into new growing areas, right? So practically doing this in a gentle way, where it's not about firing people, but it's about moving things around in a way that people don't need to fear, oh, this business unit is gonna die, this is over here, I need to do political fight to get in here. So it's possible without firing people. But it does take a lot of effort from the senior leadership.
Case of Logitech is amazing. I interviewed Bracken in Hong Kong early this year, and he said exactly, he said, the first thing I did, I fired myself and I rehired myself tomorrow with a different mindset to drive. And he used, because it's to, you need to unlock, because when you said about moving to a different mindset, you need to unlock that mindset. Yes. He said, we need to develop new things. And then all the development team, they come with new gadgets and say, no, we don't want new gadgets. We don't want new hardware. We want something different. Yeah. So it was a very, very interesting. Yeah. And they are moving very well today. Moving. I have one final question on the tool side, because you are extremely well recognized by practical tools, simple things. So what would be a practical tool on the project side and that could help organizations to move, you know, in terms of operating system and that?
We've had some conversations around tools, right? And I think you said the key word is practical, but I would also say simple and accessible. So people tend to make tools too complicated and then, you know, nobody's gonna use it. So a business tool like the business model canvas or value proposition canvas or culture map, they have a user interface and a user experience, so they need to be practical. In the more implementation space, which is more yours than ours, we work with a tool coming from a guy called Stefano Mastro Giacomo, and he created the team alignment map. Very simple tool. It's so simple, you look at it and say, well, is that gonna help? But we see from practice, with four basic questions, you can align a team. And if you always come back to those four basic questions, teams in very, you know, turbulent, changing times, they will always be aligned and they'll get through the project. So team alignment map is one example, you know, of a tool that I like in the transformation and project space. But this is your space, right? So
I heard a quote, somebody saying, I don't know if it was Rita, complex problems need simple tools. And I think what we see today is complex problems, but with a complex tool. And I think, therefore, the success of the business model canvas. So I think in project management, what we've seen is that there is a lot of tools, but they've been developed mostly by engineers for engineers, very precise. Yeah. They're great for building big infrastructures. But we don't have the tool yet, which is the simple one. And the project canvas is something that I'm trying to develop to help anybody who wants to manage projects to have that basic key understanding. But definitely we need the tools to succeed in transformation.
So look, it's wonderful. First, I want to really thank you both. I know you are busy as a chair. You are speaking right now, so really to contribute to this discussion. So I hope you all enjoy that. So see you next time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ricardo.